Praise God, church. Praise God again. As you've heard, my name is Naomi Theuri. That is my family. So, ata mkikata kusema amen, kuna watu wataniambia amen. I am very honored and privileged and humbled to be standing in front of you today. Kona swali, how many have been preached to by a 20-year-old before? Aya, kuna wengi. Okay. Sawa. So yes, I am 20 years old. I go to university in the US. So it's called Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. What else about me? I am going to my second year. And I am part of that family once again. And today we're going to be listening to God, both of us, you and me, together. We're both learning. Also, disclaimer, nikianza kuongea kama wazungu, it's because I'm nervous, sawa. So just lift your hand, mkikosa kuelewa, I'll switch back, sawa. Let us pray once more. Dear Lord, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for this chance to stand in front of your people and be your vessel. I pray, oh God, that I will not be speaking, but you will be speaking through me, oh God. I pray that you will just have your way, oh God. I present myself and I ask that you will just use me to do what you want to do with your people this day. Bless us together, oh God, and may your name be glorified at the end of it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay, so today we're going to be, let me go back kidogo. So I am a very stubborn person, like personally, kama unanijua, I'm very stubborn. But this week I had a meeting with Pastor Moshigadi. Praise God, Pastor Moshigadi. Young people, listen to your pastors. Just have fellowship with them. It's a stream of living waters. You know, they get from God and they give to us. Okay, just sit down with them and listen to them and they will bless your hearts. Anyway, so I had a meeting with him this week. And I was telling him I don't know what to tell the people of God. And he told me to tell the people of God what has been on my heart recently. And what had been on my heart is preaching this Sunday. Sorry, I don't know. Sasa, I had a completely different message before that meeting. I was thinking about a very different thing. But I was also struggling with, I didn't feel adequate to stand in front of this pulpit and preach to you people. Because, I mean, some of you have raised me. I can see a few of my mothers. You know, I'm just 20 years old. That is what was in my heart and has been in my heart this past week. And so because of that, that is what God has been teaching me this past few days. And I'm going to tell you what I've been learning recently, which is becoming a vessel for God's use. So we're going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 4 to 9 in the New Living Translation. Please. Ama express na yekangwe kwa nini, kwa screen. Imejam. Ati? 1 Corinthians 1, 4 to 9. Tujipange. Okay, sawa. So this is what the Bible says. I will always thank my God for you and for the gracious gifts he has given you now that you belong to Jesus Christ. Through him, God has enriched your church in every way with all of your eloquent words and all of your knowledge. This confirms what I told you about Christ is true. Now you have every spiritual gift that you need as you eagerly wait for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will keep you strong to the end so that you will be free from all the blame on the day when our Lord Jesus Christ returns. God will do this, for he is faithful to do what he says, and he has invited you to partnership with Christ, with his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Express kusema kweli haikuangi hapo juu. Inakuanga ni leo tu. Okay, sawa. We will do with what we have. So, first thing we're going to talk about is God's call and his faithfulness. So, God was just reminding me this week that I would not be here had it not been for his call. And none of you would be in his presence this day and would be in salvation if he had not called you, because he's the one who calls us from our sin, right? We all agree, sindo? It is God's call that we are here this day. And you have been called to be his own holy people. And it's not because we do something so that we become holy. We have been made holy through Christ Jesus. And he does that in his own time. So now what happens after God has called us? Because we have agreed that God has called us. In verse 8, Paul tells the Corinthians that Christ will sustain us till the end. Okay, let me read it again. So he will keep you strong to the end so that you will be free from all the blame on the day when our Lord Jesus Christ returns. So I was also learning that the assurance of a believer isn't that when you stop, God will save you even after you stop believing. The assurance is he will keep you believing till the end. He will sustain you. He will hold your hand. He will make sure he does this till the end so that you will be blameless till the end. And how do we know this? And how do we have assurance of this great fact? It is because God is faithful. And God is faithful to his word, not because of what we have done. He will keep us in his calling. And I'm saying this because I have been a Christian for maybe 20 years. 2010 years now, right? 10 years now. And like in those 10 years, I cannot say it has been a smooth path. It's been every day I've been waking up and reading my Bible and not sinning. I would be lying to you if I told you that. It is a walk of ups and downs. We fall down, we get up. You know, it is not a smooth sailing. It is like a rough sea. Sometimes it's like a sea. Sometimes it's smooth and calm. Sometimes it's rough. So this is why I am saying this day that Christ will sustain us. It is not... We don't, he just loves us so much. He called us to have fellowship with him, and he'll keep us till the end. He will keep his calling upon us till the end. And that is such a blessing to me, and it takes off a lot of pressure, you know. And he will do this because he is faithful to his word. He says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful because he cannot deny himself. So he will keep you, not because of you, but because of him. So just like trusting in his call upon your life. Oh, thank you. Hallelujah. It is showing on the screen. And then after learning that God has called me, and I did not choose to be here, by the way. I did not tell Bishop, by the way, Bishop, today I feel like on the 19th of August I want to preach. That is not what happened. God in his wisdom placed it upon Bishop's heart for him to give me this opportunity today. So just resting on the fact that it did not come from me, it came from God. And whatever God has called you to do did not come from yourself, it came from him. And he's telling you this day that he's going to sustain you till the end. He will give you the strength to keep going and doing whatever it is that he has called you to do. Now, it gets to a place where I come to me. As I told you, I was feeling inadequate and like insecure. You know, I have not been tithing as often as I should. I have not been praying every day as I should. You know, I have not. There's so many things that we know that we should do and that are good things. But then I have not been doing them because I am human. But grace is enough and grace is good. But now thinking about all of those things, I was like, Jesus, I cannot do this, you know. Like looking at all the list of things that I have I've not done is longer than the list of things that I have done, you know. And I'm not sure other people feel insecure and inadequate, but I did. And I hope that this is, I'm just telling you what I've been learning. I hope this will bless someone. So there's a man called Bill Johnson, a man of God. He wrote a book called When Heaven Meets Earth. And he writes this. In my own pursuit of God, I often get preoccupied with me. It was easy to think that being constantly aware of my faults and my weaknesses was humility, but it's not. I am the main subject, talking incessantly about my weaknesses, and I have entered into the most subtle form of pride. And I was surprised because I'm here saying the way I am not worthy. You know, I have faults and I have weaknesses. But I am shifting the focus from God who called me to me and all the things that I have not done or I have done. And now it stops being humility, it becomes pride. And we know how much God hates pride, you know. So it was just, and we know very well, remember Matthew 14, 28 to 30, when Jesus was on the water in this, I think, Sea of Galilee. And Peter was like, Lord, if it's you, call out to me and I will walk on the water. And then he comes out and he walks. And then he sees the wind. He was looking to Jesus. Then he looks to the wind and sees it is strong and says, Lord, save me, I am drowning. And at that point, when he shifts his focus from Jesus to the wind and to himself, he drowns and he falls. So this is what I had been doing by thinking about these things. I'm shifting the focus from God to myself. And that was not the plan. And I thought that I was doing it in the most nicest of ways. I'm just saying I am not enough, you know. But I'm also talking about me, and not Christ who called me. So even in you and your calling and what God has called you to be, think about it. Where is your focus? Are you thinking about how you're not enough or how God has called you and how amazing and wonderful he is upon your life? You know? Yes, thank you for nodding. You're blessing my heart. I go to a church in Nashville, Tennessee, and it's a very small church, very small, about, like, the whole church is half of you people who are here today, but it's an amazing church, and I love it. And recently, our pastor was preaching to us about Peter. Peter was the leader of the 12, Peter the disciple of Jesus. He was the leader. He's the one Jesus told, upon this rock will I build my church, right? But do you also know how many faults Peter had? Are you also aware of how many faults Peter had? And he was rebuked numerously. There's no disciple who was rebuked as much as Peter was. Because, you know, he was not perfect. But we make, I think in Sunday school and growing up, and before he even preached this sermon, Peter was, you know, the person that you want to be. I had put him on a pedestal, like this is the hero of Christ, you know, no sin, and forgot that it is only Jesus who's not blameless. Peter had his own faults, but God still used him with his own faults. And not that I am saying this so that we rest and be like, oh, God has called me, I don't have to work on my weaknesses. No, you still have to work on them, but just trusting in the fact that, trusting in God's wisdom. God knew you and he called you knowing you as you are. You know, he called me knowing me as I am and all the things that I had done or not done, you know. But in his wisdom, he decided that on the 19th, it is Naomi who's going to be preaching to the church of God, you know. And it's not like he had forgotten all those other things that I was thinking about when I was saying I was not adequate enough. And just learning to trust in his wisdom, that he knows best. He says in Isaiah 55:8-9, if we can have that, that would be amazing. We have it. Oh, I have it. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. And he was just reminding me this past few days, to rest upon that, you know. Mimi nadhani najua, lakini nilijua sijui. I learned that I do not know. It is like just resting on his wisdom and coming here with the knowledge that he will speak. He will do whatever he wanted to do with me, you know, and he will do whatever he wants to do with you. For whatever he has called you to do, I have no idea what is going on in your lives. I have no idea what God has placed in your lives. But I'm telling you right now to trust in the wisdom, in God's wisdom, in knowing that he knows what's best. And he saw you and he knew that you were enough to do whatever it is that he has called you to do, you know. And his strength is made perfect in your weaknesses. So maybe that is why he called you, so that he may show through you and not you yourself. Okay. So just anytime you think about your inadequacies, just remember that the calling did not come from you. It came from God, and you trust his wisdom. And once again, Pastor Mwashigadi, can I quote you? Okay. Thank you. So during this meeting, I'm telling you, he blessed my heart. Thank you so much. May God bless you. So he was telling me recently Harvest Conference was happening and he was organizing Harvest Conference and all of those things. And he said it got to a point, he was praying so much, but he was praying, and then God asked him if he was praying out of worry or out of faith. Think about it. When you're praying, do you pray out of worry or out of faith? Because it's not wrong. God is our strong tower. He's the one we run to when things are not right. But also, do you have faith in him? You know, are you praying knowing, oh, he's going to sort this out? Am I just like, aki mungu, sijui nifanye nini, aki no, 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 no. And even then, maombi hasitoshangi, utashinda hapo umeomba kitu moja the whole day, the whole week. Instead of just trusting that he has, he got you, he loves you, you know. He does not want any of us to perish. He just has, he's amazing, you know, his love is amazing. It's a whole other new someone. We just had Holy Communion, and just thinking about the sacrifice on Calvary's tree can make you, can just bring tears to your eyes, you know. Just, I don't know. I think I am those kinds of people who I want to to do everything and do it to completion. Like, nataka nifanye, ata sitaki mtu mwingine afanye, because I don't trust that they will do it well enough as I would. But now God is telling me, you relax. You know, relax. Just have faith in me. I am going to do this thing, you know. And it was, I am still learning, by the way. It's not that I am perfect at nimejua kabisa. We're still learning together. And then, another thing is, sometimes when you're serving God, you want to be on top. You know, kama ministry flani, maybe you're an usher. You've been an usher for so long, mpaka umefika mahali unaona, I can be a better usher than Washu. What is Washu doing? God bless you, Washu. You know, and we just want to be the ones there. Unataka uonekane. Sawa, Mungu amekuita and he's called you to do this thing, but you also want to be the one apo juu. You know, maybe God has called you to be kamuko security. I don't know who's the head of security, but you are number two. And then you feel like, now it's about time. I feel like I have grown. Mtu ajui kenye nafanya. I need to be number one. You know, and that is not from God. That is also shifting the focus from serving God to yourself. And that line, I want us to read Philippians 2, verse 1 to 8, in the Message version, please. Okay, so this is what it says. Philippians 2, verse 1 to 8. So you can start from verse 1. Thank you. If you've gotten anything at all out of following Christ, if his love has made any difference in you, if being in a community of the Spirit means anything to you, if you have a heart, if you care, then do me a favor. Agree with each other, love each other, be deep-spirited friends. Don't push your way to the front. Don't sweet talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Let's just pause there. Put yourself aside and let others get ahead. That is not easy for me. I'm not sure about you, but that is not easy for me, you know. Like, let me lift you. Oh, wenda uko juu, mimi nitafika out venye nitafika mimi mwenyewe. You know, like, tutakuwa mimi na Mungu, but we fika kwanza. Put yourself aside, help others get ahead. Anyway, let's go on. Don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand. Think of yourselves the way Christ Jesus thought of himself. He had equal status with God, but did not think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status, no matter what. Not at all. When the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity and took on the status of a slave, became human. Having become human, he stayed human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life, and then died a selfless, obedient death. The worst kind of death at that, a crucifixion. So, I don't think there's anything more I can say past that verse. It just says it all, you know. forgetting about yourself. Thank you, Dad. Forgetting about yourself and pushing others to the front. You know, don't look at your own desires, but lend a helping hand. You know, stop looking at, you know, I have, tomorrow is Monday, I have to go to work at 8 a.m., I have to do this, I have to do that. You know, just like step aside for someone else. And he even says that, Jesus said that in Matthew chapter 18, verse 4. This is when he was, he had the little children and he was telling the disciples, whoever becomes simple and elemental again, like this child, will rank high in God's kingdom. The one who humbles himself like a child will become the greatest in the kingdom of God, you know. And sometimes when you're serving, I've just said it, you want to be the one there. You forget about humility, you know. You forget that it is not a show of what you can do. It is God calling you to do what he has called you to do. And God is reminding us today that we are vessels of his use. He's asking us to be humble, to forget about the status, and to be sons. And if we are sons, our title is servant. You are a servant before you are a master, okay? Do not forget that. You have been called to serve Jesus, not to bring glory to yourself. Okay. Gosh, I have 15 minutes left. Huh. Okay. So the last point is, before we go to the point of action, are you ready to go? Are you ready to go where God has called you to go? Are you ready to do what God has called you to do? And from that point, I will tell you a story. So when I was in school, like they have all these opportunities to do charity and things like those. So they had this chance for us to go and fellowship with the homeless people in Nashville. Hata huko kuna kwanga na watu wanalala kwa streets. Even more there than here. So praise Jesus for that. No, not praise Jesus that people live on the streets. I'm sorry, just... Okay, sorry, I didn't mean that. But now, it was just an opportunity to go. So there's this one church, I don't remember the name of the church. They hold like a cleaning clinic every once in 2 weeks. So there, all the homeless people around there know, people experiencing homelessness know, that I can go to this church and they will give me food that day. I will have a place to shower and they'll give me new clothes and I will get a haircut. Like they just clean you up so you look nice. So we went. And now my job was to give people pedicures. Mimi nilikuwa ni sugue miguu ya watu na nikate toenails. Not that I was qualified in any way, by the way. Hata zangu na shindanga kukata sometimes. But, you know, hiyo ndio ilikuwa kazi yangu. And, surprisingly, kukata nini? Toenails za watu is a great way to get people to talk to you about their lives. You know, mkutu hapo, unasugua miguu, na umekata hizo kucha, na kuambia life story. So anyway, I met this guy called Harry. So Harry is a retired industrial engineer. And he sleeps on the streets. First, that was a shock to me, because I'm studying engineering. Gosh, don't end up on the streets. Anyway. So Harry was not a Christian. Harry had just, like Americans, the Christians are a small bunch. So him, he had grown all his life, figuring his way out through Nini. Paka ka retire, you know, like he's lived all this time. And then one day people knocked at his door and they asked if they could preach the gospel to him. And then this day Harry decided, okay, sure, come on in. And then wakaingia na hawakutoka. Like they just went in and they stayed there. And then their goal changed from preaching the gospel to running a drug hub and, you know, a house for prostitutes, all of those things. So they twisted the gospel of Christ to just get into this man's house and like displace him and all of those things. So he had to move because he had to leave because he was not comfortable. Like women were just coming in, they use his beds and the beds in his house to do their business. And then they're selling drugs and all of these things. He said, I don't want this. I'd rather leave. And I didn't ask him about his family, why he didn't go to his family, but he just like stayed on the streets. He became homeless after that story. And when Harry got to the streets, he encountered Christ, the real true Christ, and he gave his life to God. And at first, I was so surprised by this story, kwa sababu wale watu wamekukosa kwa hii situation, walidanganyana na huyo Mungu. Lakini bado huyo Mungu ndio umeendea. And he gave his life completely to Christ. All Harry does now, he has nothing, by the way. He goes days without eating. He sleeps on the streets with no blankets. It is very, very cold, by the way. But all he does is giving people words of encouragement, you know, raising people up, just preaching the gospel of Christ wherever he is on those streets. And it was mind-blowing to me, you know. Because, before I even go there, he calls himself WIP, which is Work Humbly in Progress. He calls himself Work Humbly in Progress. God is working on him. And he gave me permission to use the name, so you can feel free to use the name. WIP, Work Humbly in Progress. And he's saying all of these things, and he has given himself fully to Christ when he is on the streets with nothing. You know nothing. Adingoza kuvana pewa na mtu. And I was... The fact that I am telling you the story, and I also wrote it in my book, shows how much impact Harry had on me. Because I want to question God so many times when bad things happen. I want to get angry and demand stuff, like, why am I here? You know, I have worked all my life. Why am I here on the street? But Harry does not do that. He just gives himself fully to God. And I was asking myself, when will I realize that God is inherently good? You know, like, despite my circumstances, God is good. Like, there's no badness, like, there's nothing bad with him. God is just good, no matter what is going on in my life. And just giving yourself freely to his will, trusting that he will make something beautiful out of you, you know. And so many times, when God tells me to do something, I'm like, okay, fine, but first, give me this. Give me this and then I will do. You know, let me have this and then I will go. It is a transaction. Sifanyi peke, you do this and then I do this. But that is not who God is. God does not work like that. God is sovereign. God doesn't take instructions from any man. God wants you to avail yourself as you are. Acha kusema, wacha nipate pesa kidogo zaidi, and then nitaenda. Unajua, ama wacha December ifike, ama wacha niolewe kwanza, and then nitaenda kufanya hiyo kitu Mungu ameniita nifanye. Ama sijui wacha mtoto wangu ajoin nursery. No, God does not work like that. God is calling you as you are right now. As Harry was, God is using him. And so many people have come to Christ and learned of salvation through Harry, who has nothing. You have a place to sleep. You have food every day. But still, you're giving God conditions for him to use you. You know, and we tunaimbanga vizuri sana, led by our beautiful worship team. I surrender all to you, withholding nothing. But do you think about that? Do you think about if God told you today, move out of your house, I will show you where you will go. Will you go? Kusema tu kweli. But he has called us to live a life of abandon, a life of, I am ready to go, now let's go, you know. That is the life he has called you to do too. And that is what he was asking me to remind you this day, you know. And Harry does not complain. Even when he was telling me this story, he was encouraging me through his story. Me, who goes to school on a full scholarship, I have no financial need whatsoever, I am just satisfied, I have everything. But Harry is encouraging me. Sijai kosa chakula. But uyu, amepata chakula leo for the first time in 3 days. But he's encouraging me. I felt so challenged, guys. I felt shook to the core by Harry. And God bless Harry wherever he is. May he provide unto every one of his needs. But, you know, even in that circumstance, he acknowledged that he was still blessed. He still had something that God would use. And all of you, if Harry had something, all of you have something that God could use. And he's asking you this day to give it to him. He's asking you to surrender fully. You know, I don't know if I have spoken, I am getting towards the conclusion of this short, I don't know, message. I hope you will become Harris. You will become works humbly in progress, you know, considering all of those things that God has reminded you and me today. And then, of course, because I go to school and teachers give us homework, I cannot leave you without homework. But I will call it a point of action. So this one, I want us to go to 2 Timothy 2 verse 20. NLT version, please, if it's possible. Thank you, thank you. So this is Paul writing to Timothy, encouraging him, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, and that good story. And then he tells him, in a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver, and some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions, and the cheap ones are used for everyday use. Thank you. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready for the master to use you for every good work. Let me just repeat. No, it's okay. Let me just repeat 21. If you keep yourself pure, this is what it is saying. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready. You'll be ready for the master to use you for every good work. You'll be ready for the master to tell you, get up and go, and you go. But what is he saying? If you keep yourself pure. But now, see, oh, there's utensils of good use, of silver and gold, and those of dishonorable use. And obviously, we want to be utensils of honorable use, you know, of gold and silver. So now, what God is telling us is he uses people who flee sin and pursue godliness. And oh, akina jiaminianga sana, apart from being stubborn, I also... I don't know what it is. Nasemanga, ini dhambi kwa hapa? Koni tafanyana nini? We can coexist. Iko nini? But let me tell you guys, flee. Toroka. Chukua viatu toroka. And that's what you think. Flee sin and pursue godliness. And then you will be ready for God to use you. But what is... It always confuses me. I don't know if it's confused anyone until today. God also says our righteousness is like filthy rags to him. Sindo. And I'm like, sasa, you're telling me to flee sin and pursue godliness, but also my righteousness is like filthy rags. What do you want me to do? But then he's telling us to avail ourselves to the means of cleaning that he provided through Christ. That is what he's asking of you. Just go to the cross. Nothing but the blood of Jesus can take away all your sins. So avail yourself to the means of cleansing that he has provided through Christ. And then you will be pure, and he will sustain you till the end, and you will be ready for him to use you to do whatever he has called you to do. Thank you so much for listening to me, and may God bless you.